You got the real deal now. Gonna kick this sorry ass out on the street.
How's it going, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to week number 49 of the Lowdown Show Brain Wars on No Holds Barred Wrestling Podcast. We are your Canadian-based WWE podcast that reviews and discusses Monday Night Raw and Tuesday Night SmackDown from the past week. Also, during our show, we have our segment called The List of 10 and WWE Headlines, where we talk about any important news related to the WWE. Every week, the Lowdown Show is broadcasted live right here on Spreaker, available at Spreaker.com/NHBWP, or on the Spreaker app, available for all Android and Apple devices. And after it is done recording, the podcast is posted in full on Spreaker itself, on our YouTube channel, YouTube.com/NHBWP, and it is also available for you on iTunes by searching the Lowdown Show Brand Wars. So go check us out wherever is easier and convenient for you to listen to us. You can follow the podcast on Twitter as well and join in the conversation by tweeting and having your thoughts and questions here on the podcast by tweeting and following at NoHoldsBarredWP. And I am your host, the self-proclaimed greatest host, Kyle Masters. And every week I am continuing to be joined by my co-host, the boss, Mr. Corporate himself, Corporate Cappy.
Rude.
The blissful boss.
It's a rude week this week.
Rude week.
Rude.
Yes.
The weather outside has been brutal for
us on the northern eastern seaboard here. We've had a rough couple of days.
Two snow days at school this week for me.
In March. Greg says, what's up, guys? What's going on, Greg? I don't know where you're from, but it's been brutal for us up here, man. The snow has been crazy the last, like, what, 3 days?
Yeah, the only good thing about it is I got to watch SmackDown because it was a snow day.
Because we got a snow day.
Yep.
And I didn't work, so I was off, and I got to experience Mother Nature's gift of snow.
Shovel it out, man. I literally shoveled 6 times in 2 days.
Oh,
gotta love Canada.
Yeah. He's from New Jersey, so he felt it.
Oh, okay.
He's just eating right now.
Mm. Mm.
All right.
I'm pretty hungry. Stop talking about eating.
Yeah, no. I just actually had food, so I'm good. Anyways, before we start the show off, I got a rant.
Oh, great.
Oh, yeah. The great Kyle Master
rants.
We got
the blissed off moment of the week here.
Yeah. Okay. So, today, I was in my boy Toronto Traffic. You guys don't know, Toronto is famous for a couple of things. You know, you got the Blue Jays, Toronto Maple Leafs, and it's traffic. Okay. The traffic is really bad. Today was, I don't know why. I was stuck in traffic for 2.5 hours today. Okay? 2.5 hours on maybe a piece of highway that stretched about, I don't know, a 3-minute drive if it was no traffic. 2.5 hours. Okay? 2.5 hours. By the time I got to the end of the traffic, okay, and is seeing what all the commotion about, I'm like, it's probably going to be an accident, right? It's usually what it is. It's an accident or just a high volume. It was either one or the other. I get to it, okay? And it's a bus. A giant bus that looked like it caught fire. It was flipped over. It covered all the lanes. Now, here's the best part. It wasn't even on my side. It was on the other side of the highway. People were just slowing down and stopping to see the knocked over bus. And as soon as we got past that, it was clear. There was nothing. There was no debris on our side. There's no cops on our side. There's no anything on our side. People just slowed the hell down to look at the knocked over bus. It's like you've never seen an accident before. Who cares? Yeah, it's okay. A knocked over bus. Wow, man. Whoa. Does it mean you have to slow down the entire fucking highway for 2.5 hours so you can look at a down bus? That was it. I could not believe. I'm like, I would get stuck in traffic for 2.5 hours because there's a knockdown bus in the other lanes, like the other side of the highway that had nothing to do with us, didn't affect us in any way. I could not. I was so pissed off. I'm like, really, 2.5 hours for that shit? And then it took me, I don't know, 40 minutes to get home from there. Unbelievable, man. You people that do that in traffic, I don't understand, man.
You just made the list.
You didn't have seen an accident before? Like, whoa, man, stop the car! God, stop this. Wow, a knocked over bus. Whew. Yeah, hey, everyone, stop. Come take a look at this.
God, good thing they didn't cause an accident behind them by stopping.
I'm surprised there wasn't an accident on our side. Unbelievable, man. Just, I saw that, I'm like, you've got to be shitting me. Unbelievable. Greg, knockdown bus. Watch it burn, man.
I don't know if it was burning, but...
Oh, it was. There was fire crew there, and you could see it was charred. It was a charred bus. But
a charred bus?
Unbelievable, man. I can't believe I went through 2.5 hours of traffic for that shit. Right, so rant done. You. Rant done. I just... People that cause that just mind boggles me, man. What are you doing?
It's like a bunch of Kevin Dunn's.
Go YouTube or Google a bus accident, okay? You'll probably get 10 times better videos than what you just seen.
Don't you have somewhere better to go than watch this bus?
And it costs 2.5 hours of traffic. Unbelievable. Anyways, move on here. Before we start the show, got some news. Lowdown in Orlando, as we announced 2 weeks ago, is a all-day podcast on Saturday, April 1st from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. The first 3 hours, we're going to do the Lowdown show, and I kind of botched up a little bit here. I didn't know, but my corporate co-host here reminded me before the show today. Takeover Orlando is on the Friday. I thought it was a Saturday night, and the Hall of Fame is actually a Saturday night. So instead of going over the WrestleMania and Takeover card on the Saturday as I initially planned for the show, we're just going to do the WrestleMania card, and we'll do a Takeover review. Basically, we're not going to do predictions. I don't know. Maybe we'll do a predictions podcast that week. Who knows?
We'll post what we think's going to happen.
We'll do something like that. But yeah, the first 3 hours of the Lowdown in Orlando is going to be the Lowdown show, which we'll do the Raw and SmackDown review, and we'll also do, you know, we'll do NXT, or we'll do maybe we'll do the Takeover review into the Lowdown. We'll do something like that. I don't know. We'll think about it then. At 2 o'clock, we'll take an hour break. So me and Corporate Cappy can take a break from talking for 3 straight hours and go get some food, and we'll come back from 3 to 5 p.m. We'll take all your Skype calls, and we'll just talk wrestling till 5 o'clock. No, do what we gotta do. I'm expecting a lot of Skype calls that day. So, guys, maybe. I got some contests being drawn up for that too. So stay tuned for that.
Maybe we're gonna have to come up with a schedule for these Skype calls.
I heard that you can't if you're on a Skype call and someone else calls at the same time. I've been reading you can't actually mute it or put them on hold. So it's going to be tough to organize the Skype calls, but we'll make it work. We'll figure it out. So, guys, share with everybody. Get the word out. Lowdown in Orlando, Saturday, April 1st from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m.
Going over everything for that WrestleMania, you know, great main card.
Yeah, you know, as lackluster as WrestleMania is this year, we're still going to do it. I really want to do it.
And we're going to WrestleMania.
At our local theaters.
Yep. I got my ticket today, and they said 2% of people.
Yeah. So we got the word out to all our buddies. Like, yo, you got to buy your ticket now. It's only 2% full. Just get a ticket now. Why not? You aren't getting charged tax. Why not? Why not get it right now? Just in case. What if, like, the week of, and you wanted to wait till, like, the day before, a huge barrage of people came through and bought all the tickets? You never know. So, yeah, get it now. Anyways, Michael Chow TV. He's 2 episodes deep now and are fantastic, by the way. So good, Michael Chow, for your debut of your podcast, our 2016 Fan of the Year's own podcast. Great 2 episodes. I like the ideas. I like Michael Chow is really knowledgeable in the sport of professional wrestling. So go check him out, guys. Go follow at Michael Chow TV on Twitter and go check out his new podcast.
And he's got contests as well on there.
Yeah, he's got contests as well. So go check it out. One of our loyal fans here at No Holds Barred Wrestling Podcast. And the last but not least, shout out to our February Twitter Fan of the Month, Glorious Greg. Shout outs to you, man, for winning February Twitter Fan of the Month. Guys, if you want to know what Twitter Fan of the Month wins, they get the shout out just like I just said, and they get their tweets read first right here on the podcast, which we'll get into now. Your Twitter tweets out there about Raw and SmackDown from the week. And we'll start off with Glorious Greg at xgilly929 on Twitter. He puts... Number one, if I can find the number one tweet. Yes, there it is. Raw gets a 3 out of 10. And how do you feel? Okay, wait. Whoa.
Twitter's Greg. Update, but.
I don't have a number one here, Greg. Where did you put that number one, man? I think it starts right here. How do you feel about the buildup of Miz Maurice versus John Cena and Nikki Bella feud? And I get, oh, okay, see, it is not organized. Greg, what are you doing to me, man? You make me botch live on the air here. So I'll just go from what you put in the Twitter thing right here. Raw gets a 3 out of 10. How do you feel if the Reigns versus Taker match becomes a triple threat with Braun joining the fray? Oh, hell, I hope not, man. I saw what Braun did this week. I'm like, oh, my God.
What? The only way I would want that is if, like, Strowman pinned Reigns or something.
Yeah.
Taker wasn't involved in the decision.
Yeah, it's okay, Greg. I forgive you. Don't worry. You won Twitter Fan of the Month for February. Don't be sorry. you get the bye just like SmackDown has the last couple of weeks.
Not this week.
If that happens, for some reason I'd be more okay than just Reigns versus Taker alone.
At least I can get behind Strowman winning.
Yeah. I'm so scared it's going to be Taker's last match, though. I'm going to be freaking pissed off if it is. Number three, if SmackDown got an extra 30 minutes added to the show, do you think the tag teams would get more TV time? Probably. It's tough because now they have 205. It's because they have 205 Live attached to it. They can't ever do that.
They can't have an excuse that they can't fit it in anywhere. Yeah. You've seen the stuff they put on this week. They can definitely take time away from something else for a tag team match.
There's a lot of promos the last 2 weeks. There's more promos than actual wrestling. So I know you're trying to build feuds to WrestleMania, but how are you supposed to build the tag team end of it if you just leave them off the show for like the
we
last
have no idea what direction it's going in.
Yeah. He also puts, should Baron Corbin leave WrestleMania with the IC title? Who should be next in line to challenge him?
Yes, he should.
Corbin Revolution.
Yes, he will leave with the IC championship. Lowdown show prediction
so.
Right there.
I hope so. I'll be happy. Greg puts in the chat, I'm coming for March Twitter Fan of the Month. Believe that.
No.
With a hashtag like that, I don't know, man. You know how we feel of Roman Reigns. All right. Thanks, Greg, for your tweets and the February Twitter Fan of the Month. Next set of tweets, Casey Salvis at Salvis94.
Oh, no.
Raw was okay. Undertaker and Reigns segment was good. Reigns must turn heel. He will be booed out of the building at Mania. If he doesn't, the last segment was... he'll be booed out of the building at Mania if he doesn't. The last segment was awesome. Can't wait for Rollins versus Triple H. Hopefully Mick Foley is gone for good. And Angle is the new GM. 6 out of 10.
Wow. Generous rating from Casey Salvis.
Very, very generous. Next is SmackDown tweets from Casey Salvis at Salvis94. SmackDown was good. I can't believe I'm saying this, but I can't wait for Shane versus AJ. These backstage segments got me. Hang on. It didn't organize Twitter this week, obviously. Got me interested in the match. Hopefully the rumors aren't true and Styles is not going to Raw after Mania. Well, I got some news about that. And he will be ruined. Yeah, duh. SmackDown needs a big star then to replace him. What do you think? Apparently Vince wants Nakamura on Raw 2. And Cena is leaving after Mania. So who do you guys think think about that? And SmackDown was good. 7 out of 10. If Vince wants to put Nakamura and Styles on Raw, I think that's a little overkill. I don't think that's actually going to happen.
It's because he's moving the big dog
over to Vince. It's probably going to be with Roman Reigns to SmackDown.
Because he's definitely worth Styles and Nakamura, not.
No. Nope. Greg says SmackDown's storytelling is just godly.
It's good.
It's good. Next set of tweets, and sarcastically, I might add, once again, are from Prince Jones, at TWFS Prince Jones. Part-timers are the only good thing about this shit. The only people who actually have talent. These full-timers suck. Raw 10 out of 10. A show. Hashtag facts.
All right.
SmackDown 2 out of 10 for Corbin and AJ Styles, the only good full-timers.
All right. Thanks, Prince Jones.
Interesting, Prince Jones, as always.
Very interesting views on wrestling.
Next set of tweets, Tony Mercer, at Recrem, why not? Raw was a normal Raw episode until the final segment. The build between Seth and Triple H took a nice turn and made things interesting. Oh, by the way, did you see that dropkick Mahal hit Roman with? That was actually sick. It was stiff and I loved it. I think he should have won off that, Tony. Which is complete bullshit, but no, of course, Raw, what does it stand for? Roman always wins. He's got to win. They could have had Jinder win here and not affect Roman Reigns going into WrestleMania. But, you know, whatever. I don't make the decisions. I don't get a boner for Roman Reigns like Vince does. That's all I got to say about that. Raw gets 5 out of 10. Tony puts for SmackDown had a down week. Yes, it has for the last couple of weeks. The only thing to talk about was AJ's beatdown on Shane. They've had a good build to their match so far, whether the match is wanted or not. Brace promo was gold as well. Just an off week on everything else. 6 out of 10 for SmackDown. Interesting views, Tony Mercer. As always, we appreciate them. Thank you for your tweets. Next set of tweets comes from Juggy Badass at Azazel YT. The Raw is Reigns was dumpster fire as always. Calls Raw is Reigns. Dana Botch attacking Charlotte. Same old Lesnar promo, but I will say seeing Rollins finally take some bumps was pretty cool. But the same old recycled shit. 100% agree with you there. 2 out of 10 for Raw. Oh, and of course... Oh, my God. SmackDown was okay, but they even had a cringing... But they had cringing moments. My gut turned in a knot when Styles and Shane match was announced. I'm with you there. I'm really hating this WrestleMania season. No buildups are grasping my undivided attention, and I'm just not going to give a shit about anything until after Mania. SmackDown gets a 5 out of 10. I might just watch Impact and Lucha Underground till after WrestleMania. But seeing Mickey the MILF is always good. Hashtag right. Fuck Vince. Hashtag fuck Bugs Bunny. Yes. And hashtag... Oh, my God. Also, one more thing. You guys should play Raw is Reigns' music whenever he is mentioned so at real Kyle Masters can be pissed. Yeah, no, we're not playing Roman Reigns' theme on this show.
It's already bad enough we do the Braun roar.
I am never playing his theme on this show, ever.
I will try to make it happen, okay?
It's not happening.
Is that from Irrelevance?
No, it's from Juggy Badass. Man. I'm not getting Roman Reigns' theme ever. ever on the show.
What about Believe That?
You can believe that I won't be putting it on this show, that's for sure. All right, next set of tweets. Irrelevance at Forlorn. There you go. Three highlights. Paul being a god on the mic. That ending segment. Oh, my boy. Just smashing into Reigns. Definitely my favorite part of the show just because of... God, Raw gets 5 out of 10. You know what? I can sort of get behind that because he demolished Roman Reigns.
It's just funny because Reigns was looking at HBK and he just gets
blindsided. I think kind of Reigns kind of oversold it. He went a little bit too far. I look at it back over and over again. I'm like, okay, he does one flip. He could have stopped himself, but he did another flip again, which caused him to go off the ramp and crash into all the lights.
His cousin's The Rock, who oversold everything. So
yeah, I got to follow him with that. SmackDown Live tweets. He put SmackDown was meh. It's being pretty met lately. I can agree with you there. Miz's promo, Wyatt's segment was cool and creepy, and AJ throwing Shane through the window was great. The camera in the car killed it for me. That ending was horrid. 5 out of 10 for SmackDown. Oh, and my boy for his third one. Why do I agree to 3? What made me to do that decision to agree to 3?
Well, Irrelevance put like 7 the one time.
Yeah. Oh, well. Thank you, Irrelevance, for your tweets, as always. Appreciate it.
Thank you for your roars.
Yep, thank you for your roars. Last set of tweets comes from our 2016 New Holds Barred Wrestling Podcast Fan of the Year. That's right. It comes from at Real Michael Chow at Michael Chow TV and his entrance theme. Guys, you're wondering why he has an entrance theme? It's because he won our 2016 Noble Spark Wrestling Podcast Fan of the Year. And if you win that, you'll get your own theme song before your tweets throughout the year and through the rest of the year. So that is Michael Chow's theme that he's requested, as always. Craig said when Roman flipped on the ramp, he's like dying for 5 minutes.
It was pretty funny.
It was. The gifts were essentially funny. Greg loves Michael Chow's theme. Awesome. Yeah, it is awesome. The rock version of TJ Perkins. I think that's better than his actual theme, to be honest. Anyways, again to Michael Chow's tweets. Raw, 3 out of 10. It's hard to build WrestleMania when Oldberg and Roy Lesnar and Lesnar's bitch, Heyman's words, not mine, only appear every other week. Only really liked the ending. I thought it would be the typical babyface comeback, but I liked that Triple H was booked to look strong. He's got Triple H clapping gif. Question. Who do you want to see win the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal this year? I'd want Cesaro. He'd be the only two-time winner, and it'd be a great push for him. I mean, what else are you going to do with Cesaro?
Well, he's going to be in the tag team match.
Or are they going to go one-on-one? Are they going to just do one-on-one, Enzo and Cass versus the club?
No, I think after what happened on Raw this week, I think they're going for the triple threat.
Yeah.
I would like them, since they don't have anything for guys like Zayn and Joe and Strowman, I would like to see them like stack the battle royale, actually make it mean something.
I think that's more, if Rollins can't, I don't know if I'd like it, but maybe Triple H gets added to it. Maybe Triple H is the one that wins it.
I would like to see them stack it so that it actually means something. Have like really good superstars.
As lackluster as the card is, I think that would be a good idea.
Instead of just having jobbers in it.
Right. And then you don't want to see Zayn versus Joe again. You don't want to have Balor come back and face Joe again. We've seen that feud for like a year straight in NXT.
So
I think it'd be great to add those guys to Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. And if I had to pick a winner, I'm picking Samoa Joe just to get his career off already to a good start, make him look dominant and getting to that that new faction that it looks like is being made. I think he'd be a good winner for that. So.
I'll take the popular pick, Finn Balor, if he's in it.
If he gets added to that. I'm still going with my theory from last week that he's going to come out and win the title from Brock Lesnar. I don't think Brock Lesnar is going to be the champion after WrestleMania. I honestly don't.
Can you imagine Lesnar?
It's too obvious.
No, Lesnar wins. All I hear is
my god,
the big dog.
Just like the Undertaker, he's gonna get the world.
Like the Royal Rumble all over again.
Done. I'd leave. I'm gonna walk out of the theater. I'm gonna walk out of the theater if that happens. But I just got this gut feeling that Brock Lesnar's not gonna be champion after WrestleMania. I don't think he's gonna be champion. I think it's too obvious. It's way too fucking obvious.
Well, he's going to be Oldberg in about 20 seconds.
Yeah. I know WWE likes to go the obvious route, but I think it's just too obvious to me. I'm going with my theory. SmackDown tweets from Michael Chow. 6 out of 10 and an okay show, but got my extra point for giving Bay Mella her spotlight going into Mania. # best super kick in the business. It was pretty decent. Like, two great super kicks by Carmella. And actually, we'll get into that later, talking about that. Tag team champs and division finally get a match in the main event. But nope. Gets jobbed by backstage Shane. Division deserves so much better. I agree. And he has the Uso just going, losing his mind there. Just facing the hands. Question. What do you see the SmackDown Live Women's Mania match being? Sadly, since I hear WWE is contacting former divas, I think it'll be a battle royal.
Oh, God.
I hope not. And I think I mentioned it last week, or I mentioned it to Corporate Cappy here. I think it's going to be a gauntlet match. But it's weird, and I say it, I think about it more now. If they're going to do gauntlet style, basically that means like the women have to run down the ramp. And it's a pretty big ramp at WrestleMania, so I don't know if that's actually going to happen.
They'll all be at the outside of the ring.
Yeah, or they'll all be at the outside of the ring, and I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen. If it's a battle royale, it's the worst idea possible.
It's so bad. It's just degrading the women's division on SmackDown for all the great work that they've done.
Mm-hmm. Oh, interesting. Greg says it'll be the debut of Asuka. If she loses the NXT title. I think that's probably...
To Ember Moon?
Yeah. Could you imagine Asuka wins the women's championship at WrestleMania? Wow.
No. I just don't want that.
Yeah, because you don't want that. Do you imagine a feud with Alexa Bliss and Asuka?
Holy well, Asuka God. Can't talk, so Alexa's going to have to talk great like she always does.
She does mostly that anyways.
What's that supposed to mean? She doesn't wrestle?
No.
Okay, next.
That's it for tweets. That was Michael Chow's last tweet. Thank you, as always. And guys, if I missed anything, I don't know if I missed anything. I think I sent out another tweet today. I'm just going to check it out. I sent out another tweet today.
We're missing a couple regulars this week.
I got a late tweet an hour ago. Luke Tonkinson. He put, Raw was okay. It wasn't the worst, and it wasn't the best. 6.5 out of 10. Missed SmackDown. From what I heard, it was good. Sad I missed it. Thank you, Luke, for your tweet, as always. Oh, we got a question from Casey. What are your thoughts about Roman Reigns? Okay, Casey, I'm going to save your question for the news part, because his question is in relation to one of our headlines, so... Okay. I'm going to save that. And boy, do I have something to rant about that if it actually happens.
We'll leave you on a cliffhanger there.
Yeah. Okay. So, thank you for your tweets, ladies and gentlemen. As always.
Can I just say, where are you at, Gamma? Where are you at, Chuck Wilson?
Oh, yeah. We're calling you out, Chuck Wilson. We're calling you at Colin Gamma NU1. And I see a new fan, Detalia, I think the name is. We're calling you guys out. Where are your tweets, man? I put tweets.
And Tyler Jones, where are you at?
And Tyler Jones, man. I put this tweet out on Wednesday. I say every week, I put the tweet out on Wednesday. All you have to do is look out for the tweet on Wednesday. Put your thought. Takes 2 minutes. Let us know, and we'll read them on the podcast. If not, then you know what? That's okay. Greg says, I love Little Miss Bliss at Corporate Cappy.
Mm. I get all the feels. You know?
Other than that, okay. So we'll get into the review part. Okay, we spent a lot of time. Me and Cobra Kai were talking. We spent a lot of time. Most of the podcast, a chunk of it, is on Raw. We feel it doesn't deserve that much time.
Absolutely not.
So basically, what we're gonna do is we're gonna do a shortened version recap, if we put it, for Monday Night Raw, and we'll do mostly the review for SmackDown. Because it's always a better show. It could be lackluster. Heck, it's been the last 3 weeks. But guess what? It's still won every goddamn week for us.
I watched the 3 hours, and it wasn't worth the 3 hours.
Yeah.
And I told you not to bother watching the whole thing.
Tyler, Craig says, Tyler Jones said he was coming for my title. Where he at?
Ooh! Call out! I love it.
Oh, man, that's great.
Selling out hardcore.
Yeah. But we'll just do the Raw recap. Man, I'm like Cooper Cappy. He's got it on his phone because I didn't bother doing a review for it. That's how bad Raw was for me. So we'll just recap it. And I got some points here and there. I'm going to chime in, and I have written down some jotted points. But
yeah.
Other than that, nothing else for that.
It opened up with the Lesnar and Paul Heyman promo talking about Brock, talking about Goldberg for Mania. I don't know. Paul Heyman said he's the Goldberg eating carnivore.
Ooh.
And F5 equals Lesnar goes up, down goes Goldberg. I thought it was okay, but obviously yeah. Lesnar just typical, standing there with a weird look on his face. Yeah. And
I mean, I don't like Raw, like starting off this way. To me, this segment did nothing for me. Like I don't, I didn't get. Like, nothing came out of it.
Yeah,
like,
it didn't get me excited for the match. It felt lackluster. Yeah.
Like, nothing stood out.
Like, although Paul Heyman is always trying to be gold on the mic, he just... There's only so much a mic work can do for me to get interested in
it's like
match.
It needed more of an edge. I know Paul Heyman cuts on Rampage. It needed a Goldberg. Goldberg needed to be there this week.
Why are they always on opposite shows? Why can't they ever be on the
same
show?
Some people like that. I don't. If they're going to build this... If they're going to build this to be your main event, why are they not on the same show? I don't understand.
Awful. Next, we move on. We got the first match between Sasha Banks and Dana Brooke.
Oof.
This Dana match Bosch. I thought was going to just be terrible, but something came out of it.
I'd be scared for your girl going to that match because if Dana Brooke does what she always does best and then Sasha gets hurt and is out of WrestleMania, how mad would you have been?
Thank Christ it didn't happen because it was a quick match. The match sucked. It ended. Bailey was at Sasha's ringside and Charlotte was at Dana's corner.
Of course.
And Sasha won with a freaking roll up.
So not even a bank statement.
No, just a roll up. Wow. Typical roll up for the win. Awful. But
again, it doesn't feel like WrestleMania season. Like you have, how are you building up anything with this match?
And why is Dana Brooke even like? Why is she brought into this picture? We're supposed to be a triple threat match.
Yes, because playtime is over.
What does she have to do with it? And then you got Nia Jax. I don't even. It's just such a clusterfuck of Raw. And then after the match, Charlotte gets in the ring and starts saying, you're pathetic, and, you know, I'm done with you, and this and that. And we get the Dana Brooke face turn.
Great. Wow. I'm so excited.
She gets
so much fun.
She beats up on Charlotte, who cuts the same promo every week and talks like a robot.
Oh, man. Just,
You got Charlotte talking like a robot. You got Dana moving like a robot.
And you got the other two robots that just don't do anything. They're just there.
And then Nia Jax is the size of a robot.
And she's somehow become a disappearing robot because we don't know where she is.
She beat up Bayley last week.
The women's division is a clusterfuck robot.
She goes from not being... She faces Sasha at Fastlane, not on the next week. The next week she beats up Bayley. Then this week she's not there again.
Great. This is like the worst feud, build-up feud. And you know, someone pointed out, actually, I screenshotted it on Twitter the other day. And this year's, okay, so there's rumors that it's still going to be Fatal 4-Way. But if it's not, someone screenshotted this, and I'm going to have you look at it first. How crazy is that?
The same fucking match.
Right? Okay, so at Night of Champions, if you guys remember, it was Charlotte the Champion versus Sasha and Bayley. This year's WrestleMania, triple threat so far. Bayley's the champion facing Charlotte. Why are we doing the same match that we just saw 5 months ago?
Because they shouldn't have done that match 5 months ago. It made no sense. No. They should have saved it for this.
And now we're possibly getting in or the inclusion of either Dana Brooke or Nia Jax.
Why can't they just have a one-on-one? Why does it got to be these multiple women matches? Why can't they
just do
one-on-one? I thought
they
were getting away from that crap the last couple years. Right? And finally, like, moving on with the women getting one-on-one matches at big pay-per-views.
I thought it was going to be 1-on-1. The rest of them were just going to be included in this old Divas Battle Royal that they had planned. Like, they were calling back women to appear at WrestleMania.
Why don't they do a women's Money in the Bank match?
Or something like that. Heaven forbid that you have one of those.
Anyways, Dana Brooke gets a face. Like, she beats the crap out of Charlotte, says, get in the ring. Charlotte leaves.
Yeah.
Dana actually got cheered. We'll see how long that lasts for. There's actually a Dana chant going.
Oh, my.
So we'll see how long that lasts before they realize how stiff she is.
Yep.
And that's it. So Dana Brooke turns face, and great. Charlotte walks out. Next, we got Akira Tozawa and TJ Perkins versus Tony Neat. Yes, we call him Tony Neat. And Brian Kendrick.
This was the only good part of Raw. In my opinion, the cruiserweights are stealing the show at every Raw. Because anything else, I can't remember anything else on Raw that actually I loved, besides the ending.
This match wasn't very good, though.
No. Yeah, I know. It's typical, less time given to the cruiserweights on a 3-hour show, let's give more time to useless crap kind of thing.
Neese and Kendrick won via pinfall. Actually, a roll-up with a hand of the tights.
Wow.
By Tony Neat.
Wow, the premier athlete is also the premier cheater.
Yeah, Tony Neat's great abs. So this match was whatever. It was basically the four participants in the
Fatal Five Way
next night on 205 Live with Austin Aries to determine number one contender. Not much to say in that match.
No,
nothing else to say. Kevin Owens in the spotlight. So he reflected on his betrayal of Chris Jericho. He said, "I'm going to take Chris Jericho's United States title just like he took my title from me. The only thing that will be left of Y2J will be the tears of Jericho. Cry it out, man."
Besides that, it's just the same promo we got last week.
I liked it.
It was good, but it's like there's not intensifying this feud enough. It's very, very, very lackluster right now. And Arizona have 2 weeks to do it, man. This would have been the perfect time to intensify all their feuds, but again, nothing. Nothing comes out of it. Greg's like, you guys should get the sound effect of Tozawa going,
No, because I hate it already. And then that leads in, and then Kevin Owens says, who needs a best friend when I've got a destroyer? And then Samoa Joe comes out. So it seems like they're going along with this alliance.
Yeah, it's gonna
be interesting. They don't hug or anything like best friends, but they do like a fist pump thing.
And there's a rumored of Pete Dunne, the...
Yeah, the bruiserweight.
Yeah, the bruiserweight supposed to be the third guy because I guess he's tweeted at them already. So there's I guess a little rumors here, tease here and there.
So at least the Samoa Joe and KO versus Jericho and Sami Zayn, and the match ends in DQ because Joe and Zayn and Owens do not listen to the ref's five count and they just destroy Sami Zayn.
Yeah.
And then after that, Jericho tries to get in the ring and he gets power bombed and lit up.
Nothing else to say.
Oh, so I don't know what they're going for with this. If they're gonna do Zayn and Joe,
I hope not. I don't want to see that at WrestleMania. I don't want to see it. Plain and simple, I don't want to see it.
Next, we got the Cesaro and Sheamus versus Enzo and Cass number one contender match. I even knew what was gonna happen in this match before the match even happened.
Yeah, we did.
The club interferes and beats the crap out of both teams.
Yeah, and.
It made the club look good because they beat up four guys at once. Which
at least
cool.
At least that way. At least it's not like they beat up one team and the other team took advantage and you know there was just a random team getting the spotlight. It made sense the club got the spotlight here and were the stronger team. The thing with the club right now for me is that it's the club. They got their old like the T-shirts that look like the Bullet Club, right? You got Carl Anderson with the BC hashtag on his kneecap. I almost think that they should be not doing the club gimmick right now until they actually do what they wanted to do originally is piece everybody together and make, you know, a Bullet Club 2.0. Because right now it's just them two and it feels like it should be something else.
It should be the Good Brothers.
Brothers. Like something. Stop doing the whole too sweet thing until you have the pieces in place, which if Styles comes over to Raw, you're going to have all the pieces in place. You're going to have Balor, Styles, and the club. And with Kenny Omega maybe come next year, you can have that whole faction again and do something with it.
It doesn't feel like the club right now.
Right now, I don't think they should be the club. It's losing it for me right now. Because look what they've done to them. And then you can't be shocked that I think that because I've been a club guy since day one. And so far, they've just watered it down. Like it's almost PG level.
They made them look weak on so many levels. Like when they lost to Reigns in the 2-on-1 match, like come on.
Greg says they need AJ. Yeah, AJ or if even AJ and Finn would be. Can you imagine all four of them together? The ratings would go through the freaking roof. Okay.
They need a faction or something. Yeah. I will say that Enzo and Cass cut a pretty decent promo before the match. It was a bunch of friggin' March Madness references by Big Cass.
But I think the last 2 weeks, they've been sounding better. It's almost like we're getting the NXT Enzo and Cass, which we thought that was going to happen when they came up. But again, they got watered down again, too. Vince just loves to water down everything, man. Whether you come from the indies or from NXT, shit that he despises, he just waters it down like crazy. Now, it looks like they're getting a little bit more freedom here going into WrestleMania, and that's a good thing because you're going to need to boost up that tag team title match at WrestleMania, and this is a good way by letting Enzo and Cass, just be get more freedom on the mic. Yeah, instead of doing some KFC nonsense off to the side.
Oh, God, Georgia Gold spokesman. So, yeah, the club beats up on both teams. So, it's obviously going to be a triple threat at Mania. Like, what other way is it going to be? Because the club keeps interfering in these number one contender matches.
And even then, I think it could be a good match. If they let these guys go at WrestleMania and let them have a decent match, I think we can get a pretty good tag team match.
Unfortunately, I think this has pre-show written all over it.
Sadly, I think you're right.
Which
hashtag
is unfortunate.
We hate Vince, Craig says.
Because you have such good talents in there, like Cesaro, who definitely deserves to be in a main show.
Yeah.
But, so, the only good thing came out of that was that the club looked really good.
Yeah.
Other than that, nothing. Next, we get the fucking dumpster fire segment of Roman Reigns.
Oh, first we get Roman Reigns and Jinder Mahal. Oh my, steroid Mahal, sorry, juice pig Mahal. There are people saying, good for you, Mahal, getting all thin and stuff, and you're doing good, you're looking more like a bodybuilder. What? Okay, do me a favor. Go look at Jinder Mahal when he first came back, and then look 3 weeks after that. He got big way too quick.
I don't care if you're Arnold Schwarzenegger or The Rock, you can't get that big that quick.
And that thin and in that good shape quick. Freaking hard-bodied Mahal.
Stick
here.
A needle in my ass, Mahal. That's what his name is. And
oh, my God.
Roman wins, but...
Shouldn't have won.
Okay,
this
but before this...
Terribly done.
He got distracted when you heard an Undertaker dung.
Yeah.
So then he got distracted, turned around into Jinder Mahal.
Like, that knee was... If you guys didn't see it, a knee or a dropkick, whatever he did, was actually a pretty decent move. And I'll give it to Mahal. Mahal, when he actually tries, he's not stiff as hell. He can actually be a good wrestler. That spot right there, Roman should have lost. I think it'd be a good false finish to not ruin his momentum going into the match with Undertaker.
And I think it would make him even more pissed off that he lost to Jinder Mahal.
Because the gong distracted him. But no, they have to make Roman Reigns look strong.
He
whatever
has to win.
Whatever that do they not realize that's what's getting him booed? People are hating him even more.
If he would lose here and there.
If he's the next John Cena, why are they doing this?
And then when that match ends, all of a sudden HBK comes out. I don't understand.
This makes sense, because off the bat, I'm like, yeah, we already know what he's going to talk about. Oh, you can't do the Undertaker. I couldn't do it. I faced him twice. And you have Roman Reigns, with all due respect. Blah, 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 blah,
I'm going to be the one. He ended your career, and I'm going to end his.
So it's a very heel thing to say. I'm so confused in what they're trying to do with Roman Reigns. They want to be, behind the scenes, it's like they want to be the next face of the company, next baby face, and he comes out and does heel shit. It doesn't make any sense. You're going to career suicide his ass at WrestleMania. It's already said and done. The coffin's already open, man. No pun intended to Undertaker, but the body bag is going to get zipped up as soon as that match is done and Roman Reigns is the winner. Bye-bye, Roman Reigns. See you later. Bye-bye, face of the company. Bye-bye, the new John Cena.
HBK did a pretty good line. He said, he's already set up shop in that head of yours. Come WrestleMania, he's going to eat you alive.
Yeah. Or Roman Reigns will just, overcome everything.
I don't know why they had HBK. Like, I understand HBK faced Undertaker twice, but, like, did this segment really need to happen? What good came out of this segment? Did it make Roman Reigns look like he doesn't care about legends?
He just needs to go heel. Mania would be the perfect place to do it. If you're going to have him go heel, win dirty at WrestleMania. If not, Darby has just buried alive, again, no pun intended, to the career of Roman Reigns and any hope of him being the next top guy. They need to give him the Rock treatment. Look at his cousin. When he started Darby, he started out what? As a face? As a Darby trying to push him as a face? People booed the
Rocky
shit out of
my
him.
Via.
Fucking hated him. Yeah. Rocky sucks. Rocky die signs everywhere. What do? They turn him heel, became the biggest corporate star rock. This company's ever seen.
Nation of Domination rock and corporate rock.
You got to stop with this nonsense of trying to push him as a babyface because it's not working.
They're trying to give him like the Hulk Hogan treatment. That stuff doesn't work anymore.
No.
Not in this day and age.
It's got to stop. He's got to go heel. So, just plain and simple, he's got to go heel.
So after that, then we had Reigns is walking up the ramp. He takes a look back at HBK, and then Reigns just blindsides him. Strowman.
I don't even know if it almost like he tried the close on him, but the momentum of Strowman was so fast, it hit him directly into the chest, and Roman just went flying down the ramp. And it looked like he seriously got hurt.
Fell
too.
Off
like,
the ramp and
oh, please,
fell into
just
the...
seriously get hurt. Just for wow. I don't hope concussions on people. I really hope he got a concussion here or something.
Just so you don't want to see the match.
I just don't want to see Roman.
So Reigns, he falls off the ramp and into like the lights.
Yeah. It's a hard spot, man.
So I don't know what they're doing with Strowman now. Like, what does this mean for him?
I don't know. He's going to be, I'm saying Andre the Giant more, Battle Royal written all over him.
Probably the what winner. Else? Actually, if Balor isn't in the Andre the Giant more Battle Royal, I'm going with Strowman. Next, we had the other Cruiserweight match, which was actually good. We had the Arya Davari, fucking theme song over there, versus the in-ring debut of the greatest
Raw
man
debut.
That ever lived, Austin Aries.
Mm, great. Austin Aries, exceptional talent. He looks so good.
He looked great.
This was, okay, again, I say it every goddamn week. Arai Davari is so freaking underrated, man.
The guy he's just getting jobbed again, by everybody. But
he's so good. I think he's actually a key member of the Cruiserweight division. And you look at, you see how he exploited the eye injury. And I love how the commentators picked up on that this week as well. Arai Davari is actually really sick. I actually love him. I love his showing in the Cruiserweight Classic as well. But he gets jobbed all the time, and it's sad to say. And it's him. It's like Mustafa Ali. Guy's got like the craziest finisher I've ever seen—a reverse 450 splash. Like, not many people can do that, okay? Or have the balls to do that. Mm-hmm. But they just get pushed aside. It's almost like the race card that Mustafa Ali plays all the time.
I feel like besides the Cruiserweight Championship, they don't really have anything to go for. I was thinking of a weird theory earlier.
Minor, do you think
why
they
don't
a minor title?
No, I was thinking, what about a tag team Cruiserweight division?
Yeah.
Like Cruiserweight tag titles.
Greg Drew Gulak.
Oh, yeah, the Philadelphia torture machine. I don't know. I feel like they need something else to go for, because besides the main title, they don't really have anything else.
No, they just get put into, like, boring matches on 205 Live. And
like, they do their best in-ring, but there's only so much the in-ring can do for me.
Like, yeah, besides the Neville and... Okay, so you got Neville and Austin Aries is about to be set up. You got Brian Kendrick and Tozawa still at each other. And then you got freaking Noam Dar and Alicia Fox doing cringeworthy shit every week on 205 Live. So other than that, you got nothing on 205.
But going back to this match, though, Austin Aries, guy's unbelievable. I've always said that I think they're selling him short by putting him in the Cruiserweight division. But hopefully it's just for a little while, short term.
I think he wins the title at WrestleMania. 100%.
I think he will, too. And I think it does give that Cruiserweight division a little bit of star power that they need because who else does he have to face, realistically?
I think like, they kind of shit the bed with Rishwan. They gave him the title, and then they just suddenly forgot about him. So,
But like you said, the whole match, he focused on the orbital bone.
Yeah.
And then Aries battled back and won via via pinfall. He did his like he does like a bullhammer type thing where he spins.
Okay, it's almost like if you guys I said it before, if you guys haven't seen it and haven't YouTubed it yet, go YouTube Okada's finishing move, the Rainmaker. It's almost exactly like what Austin Aries does, man. It's such a crazy finisher. I love it.
So that was obviously promoting him for the 205 Live match, and then might as well just spoil it now. Austin Aries won the number one contendership.
That was a pretty good match. I watched it yesterday. It's actually pretty decent.
In the Fatal 5-Way. I didn't watch it, to be honest.
It's decent.
But good for Austin Aries. Like I said, that was probably the only bright spot of this whole thing was Austin Aries' debut, in-ring debut of main roster.
The beautiful Alicia Fox.
Anyways.
Cringe.
You want to talk about cringe? We can go over this match. Oh, we got Titus O'Neil versus Corporate Big Show, a.k.a. Paul White, a.k.a. whatever, the Giant, whatever you want to call him.
There you go.
And Big Show wins in a minute. I got nothing else to say about that. I'm done. Next.
No.
Sorry, we did get Nia Jax this week.
No, we did.
But I didn't even... That's how much I didn't even remember her.
She a reappeared robot from a disappeared robot.
Bailey wins by DQ.
Yeah. I don't know. There's not really much to say about that.
Nia just beat the crap out of her. That was about it. I thought this was the week before.
Yeah.
But I guess
again,
it wasn't.
It's just lackluster because no wonder we didn't remember. We don't care.
And Sasha encouraged Bailey backstage.
They're just doing such a poor job of building this, man. Way they did a better job last year. Way better job with the first ever triple threat women's match and the first time these three gonna be ever. They did such a good backstory with it. This year just sucks. I don't care about it. And it's sad because I would care more about it if Charlotte had won at Fastlane. But they messed that up 100%.
The whole undefeated streak. Why do I care now?
I don't care about the winner now of WrestleMania because it just means nothing.
No, I mean I care if Sasha wins, but she finally gets the WrestleMania moment.
Sure. I can get behind
but
that. Whatever.
They should have waited. Bailey should have won the title at WrestleMania.
If Charlotte wins again, I'm so done with Raw's division forever until Paige comes back. That's it.
But like I said, Sasha encouraged Bailey backstage, but then didn't come out to help her after.
Ooh. Heel.
So yeah, Nia Jax destroyed the Bailey outside the ring, and Bailey won by DQ.
Great.
I'm trying to think. There was one part. Oh yeah, it was Byron Saxton and Corey Graves talking before the match.
Saxton,
oh my God,
worst
commentator. And Corey Graves ripped Byron Saxton apart so bad. He's like, you know what, Byron? I finally realized why you love the inflatable arm tube men so much, because you and Bailey both have something in common. The only love life you've ever had is a blow-up inflatable.
Oh, my God. That's so savage. How is he allowed to say that?
It was phenomenal.
Oh, man. Okay.
Corey Graves is great.
That was good.
And then...
I hate Byron Saxton, man. I hate him. I don't like him as a commentator. He's just so cringe. Just, ugh. And New Day pops. Mouthful of magic. I gotta have it. Yes, Greg. You know what, Greg? You can go buy New Day Pops. I probably won't buy them.
I am liking this slow Sasha heel turn build thing, though.
Yeah.
Like, it's coming, but they're not giving it to us right away.
Maybe
WrestleMania. Which is shocking.
It's probably the Raw before WrestleMania.
Because WWE loves to fucking rush everything.
I think the Raw before WrestleMania, we're going to get it.
I think it might be at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Next, we get the last part of the show. We get Mick Foley's difficult choice. Beginning of the show, Stephanie told him that... By the end of the night, he has to choose to fire one person on the Raw roster to trim the fat to send a message to the locker room. So he takes all night thinking about it. And he comes out, and the crowd chanted, "Fire Roman."
You know, okay, this is what I mean. How can you have him be the next John Cena? You want to groom him into the next John Cena? You can't groom him when he's like this already. That's why he should be a heel.
So Foley comes out and he says, "I've decided on one person about 10 minutes ago. I finally decided it." Steph comes out and he says, "The person I've decided to fire is Stephanie McMahon."
No, oh my God.
How can you fire the commissioner? You're the GM. You're under her. Great choice, Foley.
Oh, man.
So it leads to Stephanie obviously getting mad at that and saying, you know, blah, blah, blah. Typical Steph cringe crap.
Yeah.
And Foley saying, "They're human beings. They're human beings. I didn't know you really existed. I thought you just sat in the shadows." Talking to Triple H. Triple H comes out.
Yeah.
Huge horrible honker comes out. Paul Levesque. Triple H goes, "You're going to read the name of the city off your hand for a cheap pop.
Oh, God.
You need to tuck your tail between your legs and waddle down that ramp." Basically saying that Foley, you're going to get fired. They didn't actually fire Foley, but it's going to happen.
Yeah. It's probably going to be... Maybe at WrestleMania or the Raw after.
Triple H just completely bashed Mick Foley, saying that he never should have been the GM anyway. He's old news. Steph has a big heart, but don't mistake her big heart for weakness, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And then it leads to him telling Foley to get the hell out. Foley goes to the corner, doesn't leave the ring, and then Triple H's "What are you doing?" Walks over to him, gets Mr. Socko.
They did a good job here. They had the hard camera face of Stephanie as she's talking, while Triple H is yelling at him without a mic. And it's a cool, subtle. I like that. It's a cool, subtle way for Foley to sneakily get Mr. Socko over his hand, without us actually seeing it. So I like the production for once. Kevin Dunn. For out of that one right there.
So yeah, and then Triple H obviously is about to beat down on Foley, and then all you hear is dan 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 dan
dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan
dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan
dan dan
dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan dan And he just throws the crutch.
Yeah.
Gets in the ring.
Does a crutch drop.
Yeah. Starts beating up Triple H. Triple H falls to the outside. Then Triple H comes in the ring, grabs the crutch, starts beating Rollins' bad leg with it.
God, man. This is nuts. Like, I don't like Raw ending with authority figures, but well done with the mic skills. But
we haven't seen Triple
this.
H in a long time.
Yeah, and Rollins' thing was, him selling was, like, the best part of Raw.
He sold this so bad. He was, like, screaming in agony.
He was
getting hit by this
such
thing.
A good seller. Good for the kid,
It was actually, Triple H looked like he was actually hitting him, though, because the crutch was, like, bent in half.
And the mic skills throughout the, and again, I hate authority figures, the mic skills were awesome. Like, it got intense at one point.
Steph's horrible.
Yeah, but it got intense at one point when Triple H started bringing up, like, what about your daughter, Noelle, trying to become a WWE superstar? What about your son, Dewey, actually working in head office? You know, he's bringing up personal shit to increase this view, and I can appreciate that. And if it wasn't for Triple H, this segment would have sucked, because Stephanie could she could probably pull it off, but it would have been cringe.
It definitely wouldn't have had the same feel. And what does this mean for Triple H? Is he going to come in as the new GM?
Yeah.
What is it? Like,
I'm
what
not
is
sure. Maybe it's Kurt Angle. People said maybe Kurt Angle. But
Compared to SmackDown, it was a better ending, I guess. It was a good beatdown by Triple H.
I kind of feel maybe like this new stable should have maybe come out at this point and help Triple H. If you want to make him look down, why didn't Kevin Owens and
that's what I mean. I
Joe
thought when out? Rollins was beating on Triple H, I was like, okay, where's
Owens
and Joe?
Yeah. Like, why didn't they come out and help?
Or
know.
Why didn't Rollins get some backup?
I don't know if you guys out there feel the same way. Maybe let us know. I think maybe that they should have came out and at least done something. Because they had their moment earlier in the show, but then look. I thought they had Triple H's back. I thought that's what Triple H had him for.
I guess maybe he told them he didn't need it.
Yeah.
But what's going to go – like, is Rollins going to be ready? For this match?
Kurt Greg says, would you guys want Kurt Angle to be a superstar on SmackDown?
No.
No.
No. Enough with the part-timers.
Yeah, we're done. He can be a GM and then have his match at WrestleMania next
year. I want him to have one more match.
Yeah.
That's all I want. And that was it. That was Raw.
So
that was even... I was being generous. When I gave other people the review on that, it was like 5 minutes tops. It was bad.
The thing about now, if I can think of a review off the spot, I'm giving it 3 out of 10. It's barely a 3 this week.
I'm going to say that the Triple H part was good.
Yeah.
The Austin Aries in-ring Raw debut was good.
Yeah.
And the continuing slow build of Sasha's heel turn, so I'll give it a 3.
Yeah. And Greg, yes, we would like it if he managed or coached maybe American Alpha as a side thing until he has his match. I don't mind that either.
I agree with that.
And I got some things to talk about American Alpha, and we'll get into that when we do the SmackDown review.
I'm going
to
give Raw a 4 this week.
Oh.
I'm going to give it a 4. I thought it was better than it's usually been the last little while.
But again, it's
lackluster. Like I said, it's 3 weeks before WrestleMania, and it does not feel like it at all.
No.
They're not making me get excited for this at all. I'm glad we're not going to this.
Can you imagine if we actually went and we spent like good money on it?
I feel bad for you people that spent a lot of money on this.
Yeah. So hopefully they have something in store for, you know, because WrestleMania, there always seems to be little surprises here and there that I always like, okay, that was actually cool. Like, the last couple of years, there's been always one or two things that I'm like, oh, that's pretty cool. Like I was excited when John Cena beat Rusev 31, okay? I kind of we were all on the John Cena hate bandwagon, but then we actually wanted him to win the U.S. title because he would be a good U.S. champion. He would boost the title up, and he actually did. So.
And he defeated the big Bulgarian brute.
Yeah, so.
We'll talk about
hopefully
him
there's some surprises coming in store for this WrestleMania. So we're going to do the SmackDown review, the Blue Brand. Team Blue, as we always are.
Meh.
Barely won this week once again. Barely.
Last week, SmackDown got a pass for me, but when they give me two shows in a row like that, I got to get on their case a little bit.
Yeah.
As much as I love SmackDown, a SmackDown guy, I'm not going to come on here and just, you know, kiss their ass every week if they give me a bad show.
Yeah. Again, it doesn't feel like WrestleMania type of SmackDown as well. It felt just like a SmackDown that should have been taped like 4 weeks ago. There was some buildup.
For like two things.
For two things. It was very promo-based. Very, very promo-based. But again, it just didn't feel like it should have been a SmackDown WrestleMania show.
Basically. I felt like I was watching Raw this week on SmackDown.
A lot of content. It felt too jam-packed for 2 hours. We got into the end of the show. We all saw what happened. It needs to go a step above what they've been doing for the next 2 weeks.
Especially for your biggest show of the year in 3 weeks.
Yeah. 100%.
Feel like a build-up for, Roadblock. Yeah. I don't know.
Or another SmackDown pay-per-view.
Over the limit. I don't know. I don't care.
Something. Anyways. Opening segment, we open with Daniel Bryan backstage on the phone. I don't know who the hell he's talking to here, though.
They didn't say if it was Shane or who.
We don't know.
Might have been Jack Swagger's catering.
Yeah. Talking to his cater company, like, hey, we need you to pack up his food. He's being released, so put it in the suitcase, too. Whatever he was eating, put in the suitcase and then ship him out. AJ Styles enters Daniel Bryan's office, and he's looking for Shane McMahon. Bryan tells Styles to calm down. Styles says that he'll slap the next person that tries to tell him to calm down. Styles teases a beatdown of Daniel Bryan here. And I'm like, okay. Could you imagine if Styles and Bryan went at it? Like, that'd be a sick dream match. That's a dream match. Not this Randy Orton Styles bullcrap we got 2 weeks ago, although it was a good match. Styles continues to talk smack. Bryan says that Shane is not here, and he wants to work the situation out. Styles tells Bryan he's going to go to the ring and express his frustrations, while Bryan telling him, don't say anything that could affect your career. Interesting. Greg says, I think that Vince is the one who's been giving mess SmackDown Live shows on the road to WrestleMania. Well, who knows? So Styles is in the ring, says he's sick and tired of being messed with by Daniel Bryan and Shane McMahon, calls himself the greatest superstar of all time, and he thought that WWE would have the red carpet rolled out for him, going to the main event of WrestleMania, which, you know, they should. He is deserving of a WrestleMania main event title shot, but, you know, WWE had other plans for him.
He is the best wrestler in the company.
Yep. That wasn't the case, as he went through a hoops like a circus monkey. Styles says that John Cena wouldn't have to go through that. Cena went to his brother-in-law to get a match against him for the WWE title. Obviously. Greg says he's back, too. Thanks, Greg. Thanks for coming back with us. Styles acknowledges the fact that he lost to John Cena at the Royal Rumble, but he expected a rematch. Instead, he was put into a triple threat match where he didn't get pinned. Then Styles was put into an Elimination Chamber match. Styles goes over the controversy from the Battle Royal. Styles defeats Luke Harper 3 times. Then Randy Orton burned down Bray Wyatt's house and gets an instant title shot. So Styles basically saying he's gone through all this bullshit and he was never given a straight title shot back.
I agree. They shouldn't have been able to take that away from him just because Orton decided to go in the match.
Yeah, it seemed a little unfair story-wise, so whatever. Orton doesn't get arrested or put in jail for doing that. Instead, he's put in the main event of WrestleMania. AJ Styles had the best year of 2016. He's the reason why you are in the seats watching this show. 100%, yeah. It's your reason why. He's one of the main reasons why we watch SmackDown.
I know he's being a heel here, yeah. But he's telling the truth.
But you know what's funny? As he's saying all this, the crowd is cheering and agree with him. He was getting such a face reaction, I was dying. For all of that, he doesn't even have a match at WrestleMania. How does the greatest superstar in WWE not have a match at WrestleMania? Styles could have slapped the kale chips out of Daniel Bryan's mouth, he says. But we know that Bryan is just a puppet. Styles will have a conversation with Shane McMahon about his career. That is, even if he has one. Ooh. So some choice words by AJ Styles there. And, Mason Dunbar has joined the chat. AKA Dunbar Lair Vlogs. I am the one who made the trade with Corporate Cappy. Yes, we know who you are, Mason Dunbar. Thank you for joining the chat here.
The DDP fan.
Yeah, and tuning in here. So next, we got Becky Lynch versus Natalya on SmackDown. Decent match. Good showing by both to look strong, I think, going into the WrestleMania match. So basically a showcase match. Becky locks into the Disarmer for the win. But after the match is where, you know, it all went to... how should I put this? Fabulousness. Carmella comes out to the ring and just super kicks the shit out of both Becky and Natalya to look stronger. So for once, Carmella is not useless on SmackDown and not doing something cringeworthy with cringeworth.
I think they finally realized that, you know, we're talking about every woman being in this match. Why don't we include her?
Man, I was so happy. She looked so dominant here. Wow.
But then Cringeworth had to come out with her, though.
Yeah, of course. We get the freaking Dawn of the Species thingy over there.
Origin of Species.
Origin of Species come out.
So it was what it was. I mean, I think Becky and Natty with a good storyline could put on a good feud. But, like, there was no build-up to this. It was just kind of like, meh.
Yeah.
You know, the best part was Carmella coming out and super kicking.
Well, that was literally the best part for me, too. Greg puts, Becky yelling straight fire always cracks me up for some reason.
No, it makes
straight
me cringe.
Fire!
She is so cringe, man. I mean, I know Lynch. Becky's one of the fan favorites, but yeah. I just can't. I can't. I can't. I can't get behind Becky. I can't.
So we'll move on. We got Miz TV, and Miz's special guest, Miz himself, Vin Maurice, the It Couple, of course.
Great.
Mason Dunbar puts, what is with Carmella's relationship with that thing?
It's not really. He's friend zoned big time.
He's being friend zoned. Although he'd much love to say girlfriend. It's girl that is a friend.
Yeah, she won't let him say actual girlfriend.
Yeah. Anyways, Miz TV, Miz and Maurice are finally showing the WWE Universe the frauds that John Cena and Nikki Bella really are. Maurice shows off her wedding ring. Miz says that Nikki will never get one of those because Cena is in love with himself. Maurice says that Nikki is 10 times worse. Oof. There's some talk back and forth about the Total Divas situation, which was really, really personal. I didn't want to really get into detail of it. It was really long, but if you guys missed it, go watch. Maurice got really into detail about this Total Divas situation.
Basically saying that they got the job opportunity and she didn't.
Like Nikki got over basically screwing Maurice out of a job opportunity. They go on. John Cena and Nikki Bella storm the ring at this point, but Miz and Maurice retreat. Nikki gets on the mic and tells Cena that she's going to talk. Okay. Seems like, yeah, Cena. Here you go. This is a typical. If you just watch, when Cena doesn't talk, and he's like with someone in the ring, Cena cringes the hell out of me when he's like in the background antics.
His mannerisms and his stupid
Cena,
faces that he
relax,
does.
Relax, bro.
And he's like getting all hyped up. And
Miz's promo was just amazing. I was sad that Shinz McMahon was on TV. # why, man. Greg says, Shinz McMahon. As in Ellsworth, Cringeworth. So Nikki says that she's going to talk. Nikki asks Maurice if she's crazy. If Nikki can block someone's job, why is Maurice here? They were never best friends. Maurice made up a story to try to embarrass her and Brie. Maurice steals everybody's money because you stand there and hold the arm of someone that likes a blow-up doll. Maurice can prove herself tonight and she can come to the ring so Nikki can kick her ass.
I actually believe Maurice's story better than Nikki's.
Yeah, I think I'm going to go with Maurice's story. Miz says Nikki can't make matches. She's not John Cena.
That was great.
You can't make matches.
And he laughed like he knew it. He was like, he knew it.
Yeah.
He laughed.
Maurice will not face her tonight. Miz tries to conclude Miz TV, but Dan O'Brien interrupts him, of course. I'm like, oh, yeah. Comes DB to protect John Cena and Nikki Bella. Mason Dunbar says, I understand that everybody really pushed Cena and Nikki, but I can't stand the Miz and Maurice. You know, I think they're a really good heel couple, though. They've been breaking the fourth wall lately. And I think they're growing on me right now as a heel couple. So I think it's the best work both of them has done in their whole careers. Just saying. Does Miz think he's general? Dan O'Brien interrupts him. So he asks, does Miz think he's the general manager because his time is not up? Brian was promised a very special episode of Miz TV. All Miz did was run his mouth and then run away. Brian knows two people who want to punch Miz in the face. So the ultimate face-punching extravaganza in Orlando is booked. Miz and Maurice will face John Cena and Nikki Bella and his official folks. The mixed tag match that's been rumored for months on end is finally
Maurice's in-ring return.
Yep. I think that's going to be a really good match.
Like what they've done the last 3 weeks, especially Miz and Maurice, just with the promos they've been cutting, they've gotten me excited for this match.
I was such a hater of this when they first rumored it, and I said, I'm not going to watch it. I'm going to skip it. I'm actually probably going to
I like John Cena taking a backseat for once, not being in the main title
and
picture.
And this is probably going to be Nikki Bella's last match, so.
And people are saying this bullshit rumor about how John Cena is going to propose to Nikki in the ring.
It probably, and they kind of hinted at it this week, so it's probably going to happen. It's probably, why would you, like, hint it? Like, it's obvious that now Nikki Bella knows that John's going to do it. Why don't you just make a surprise? Why did they need to do that? I don't know.
Is it going to be, like, one of those fake proposals?
I don't know. Maybe. And then they actually proposed already. Like, it's already happened, but they do it again in the ring.
Great.
Whatever. Move on. Mickie James versus Alexa Bliss. Decent match. Again, showcasing for WrestleMania. Showcasing the heat between these two. What happened last week when Mickie James kicking Alexa in the back of the head. At one point in the match, Alexa Bliss tries to go for insult to injury, her signature move, and missed. And then gets Mick kicked to the head. And then Mickie James wins clean. Insane. And you pointed out to me it's a good way for Mickie to look strong going into the match at WrestleMania and getting to win over the champion. And you know what?
At the same point, Alexa shouldn't be losing a lot of matches.
I thought Mickie was there to put over talent. She should be the one beating the talent. I don't know. Mixed feelings about that.
I got mixed feelings too. I thought it was a pretty decent match.
Mickey still got it, man.
Mickey still got it.
I'm glad she's got a full-time contract and she's going to be traveling with them on live events and appearing more and having more matches because she can still go at her age, man. It's good.
And
I am
really
impressed.
JBL kept bringing up during the match that she only needs one to tie Trish.
Yep.
One more title.
Really? Mm-hmm. Oof.
But it was weird because they said on the, you know, when they come out and they have the little graphic there?
Yeah.
It said 5-time, but then JBL kept saying 6-time. So I don't know who's right.
No, I'll have to research that. Backstage, Styles has been waiting for. So there's a lot of backstage footage throughout the night of Shane or Styles waiting for Shane backstage in the parking lot where the garage is. And when Shane finally arrives, AJ goes to hide in front of the car that Shane arrives in. Shane is walking by, looking the other way. Styles then jumps him, and then Shane just gets his ass whooped, man. And he even gets thrown through a car windshield, man. crazy
into
spot.
An ice machine.
Yeah, and. The car windshield, a lot of people were... There's so much chatter about that and how...
I liked the car, him going through the car window, yeah. But then why the fuck was there a camera in the back seat of the car?
That's what people are saying, like, oh my god, it was made it at such an obvious spot. But I think they put that... At least we didn't get the footage until after. We didn't get it at the same moment. Could you imagine if we got it right before it actually happened? It would feel lackluster. But I'm glad we got it after just to see, like, an in-car, you know... kind of view of what actually looked like.
People say that it loses the realism when they have a camera.
To me, it didn't. To me, I actually thought it was awesome because people were pointing out that Shane probably used a blood pack. The camera actually in the car actually pointed out that he didn't. He hit his head on the top where there's still glass hanging from the top, so he cut his head. He rubbed his head against
the... God, man. Shane's risking his life everywhere.
We didn't get a Fit Finley sighting. Yeah, he comes out of nowhere and... Get the paramedics!
I guess he's a backstage guy now.
Yeah.
Good job by Shane, though.
People saying now they're getting more into this. I still cannot get behind this match. I can't. I don't want to see Shane versus Styles. I don't.
I would have liked
much
to see
this feud. The feud could be the most. It could be the best buildup out of any feud right now going to WrestleMania. I don't want to see the match.
I think I would have liked it at a lower end pay per view.
Yeah.
Maybe not at WrestleMania.
I think, again, just like we said last week, at like a Fastlane or a Roadblock, sure. Not WrestleMania. No. It should be. And there's theories out there that Shane's going to come out and bring Kurt Angle to wrestle Styles, but they should have been done this week because it was in Pittsburgh. If it was going to happen, it would have happened at this opportunity.
Because the crowd would have went ballistic. Yeah,
and they were chanting Angle throughout the night, too, because he was actually there. So the smart people and the fans knew that he was there. He's there, I guess, to film the 24 special they're doing on him. So who knows? If they're doing a 24 special, maybe he is wrestling WrestleMania. Who knows? We'll see what happens. Or maybe he won't. I don't know.
I thought it was a good job with the segments they did this week.
But... Yeah, Mason Dunbar doesn't want to see the match either. Thank you for that. But... I don't know, but again, we'll see what happens. We'll see. We'll move on here. We get Dolph Ziggler versus Mojo Rawley.
Next.
Yeah, it was okay match.
I can't get behind Mojo Rawley. I can't get behind this guy.
They're just showcasing it for the Andre Giant more battle royal purposes. Ziggler gets counted out because he walked away. Neat. We'll move on. We got the Randy Orton segment. Randy Orton gets in the ring to cut a promo on Bray Wyatt and address the situation. He says, you can learn a lot from a viper. They're cunning, fearless, and ruthless. They attack when the timing is perfect. Orton has been waiting in the grass for months.
And then he says the same shit.
Yeah, he could have attacked Bray whenever he wanted, but an RKO wouldn't have had been enough. It would have been easy. Orton decided to join in the family, earn Bray's trust, but the venom in his veins got deeper and deeper.
Oh, yeah.
I love when he... puns to like his theme and like it's just his catchphrase. It's hilarious. And again, he starts saying the same shit what he said a couple weeks ago in that Unreal promo. And I'm like, why did they need to repeat it? They get rinse and repeat shit they don't need to do. Orton has one more step to climb and he needs to finish what he started. Orton will take everything from Bray Wyatt. Then Bray appears on the Titantron. He says Orton was absolutely right about him. Bray was naked and stripped of his powers until he found his way home, or what's left of it. Orton thought he burned the soul of Sister Abigail, and so did he. Sister Abigail is a spawn of Satan and forged in hell. She still beats in the black hearts of all the apostles, and she has provided him with her power. It's Bray's duty to purge all of the infields in the life, and he'll start with Randy Orton. She lives through him now, and Bray is born again. Then Bray starts grabbing the ashes of Sister Abigail, just rubs it all over his body and all over his face, and then just screams this, like, wretched sounds just follow the buzzards. I'm like, oh my god. This promo in this feud is just so good. Bray is literally the new face of fear, man. It's already, he's even have to have his match now.
I like the whole ritual thing, the tribal thing that they were doing.
Yeah.
But Bray Wyatt should have beat Taker a couple years ago at WrestleMania. Yeah. Then he really would have passed the torch on to somebody that really would have taken and ran with it instead of Brock Lesnar.
Yeah. This was so good and so well done. I cannot wait for this match. And I'm actually glad right now it's one-on-one, although I would love to see Styles in it. But Randy Orton and Bray Wyatt
alone. Too many multi-person matches already.
These guys are going to put on a good match. And they've put on probably the best feud out of any feud going on right now. It's going to be so good. I can't wait for it. It wasn't the main event. I thought this was going to be the main event. And no, we still had some time left. Not. We got American Alpha versus Uso.
And this wasn't even advertised at all.
We got a tag team match
playoff. It wasn't advertised whatsoever.
Yeah. But again, it felt boring. There was nothing out of it. The crowd was dead. They're chanting for
Kurt Angle.
There
was nothing behind it. It was just they didn't talk about it beforehand.
It didn't feel like a main event match, but we know why. They focused on Shane McMahon. They kept showing footage of him walking out of the arena.
Yeah, they had a little tiny screen of him walking around during the match.
Yeah, and then the Usos went with a heel tactic.
I mean, I like the Usos winning to actually give them credibility going into the match.
But their feud sucks. But there's no feud.
There's no build-up. Yeah. Where are the rest of the teams?
Where's the feud for this? If they're going to have a match,
Where's the backstory?
This is going to be pre-show, 100%.
They had the Usos cut a good promo like 3 weeks ago, but nothing else.
This will be pre-show.
Where's American Alpha's response? They weren't even on the show last week. Yeah. This week, we don't hear them until the main event and this random match happens. It's awful.
One thing I want to say about American Alpha, or the Usos, I think their gimmick needs to be a little bit more heelish. They need to put more into it. Put the belts on them for sure, but I think they just feel like they're heel, but they get this thug persona. But I think they need to start doing some more thug antics.
Yeah, like attack people backstage
and
stuff
Crime Time
are
more the comedic ones. But you remember their heel antics, right? Like their thug antics. They need to do kind of stuff like that, man. Because right now it's almost fake. It's almost getting too fake for me.
Yeah, they need to go over the edge a little bit. Yeah. They need to cross some boundaries.
Start beating down on, like, with weapons, with steel pipes. Like, have show American Alpha walk into the ring. Have them get jumped by the Usos. Beat down like real thugs. Have them put bandanas over their face or something like that. Do something thug-like but that.
I see a lot of potential in the heel Usos character, but they just need to give them a little bit more.
Yeah, because I'm still getting whenever I see them, I'm still getting flashbacks.
You're still getting the heart and the paint Usos thing.
Yeah. And as for American Alpha, it's almost like they need to be original and sway away from the whole Benjamin and Haas thing. If the plan is not to have Kurt Angle with them, why even do something like this? It doesn't work. You had look what happened with the Ascension. They had the whole Road Warriors kind of thing going. Look what happened to them.
Yeah.
They failed. So I don't know. It's weird. American Alpha, it's getting almost too stale. It's almost like they're pushed too fast.
That's what I said the whole time. They should have never won the titles that quick.
Yeah. It's.
I thought the Wyatt should have ran with it until.
Both tag team divisions are stale as hell right now.
But they're not showing the SmackDown. SmackDown's got potential, but they're not showing all the tag teams.
Yeah.
Raw's only got like three teams. SmackDown has like five and that they can actually.
Four, and one's not even wrestling.
But I don't know where the rest of. Where's Brazongo? Where's the Ascension? Where are the cringe villains? There's another team that I can't even think of right now, but they're all these teams.
Rhino and Slater.
Yeah, Rhino. There you go. Where's Beauty and the Man Beast?
Yeah.
So
who knows? So before we even go off air, Shane McMahon comes back from backstage, and we're cutting it close here, man. I'm at 11:59 or 10:50 or is it 10:59? Yeah. No.
8 to 10, so 9:59.
Yeah. Okay. 9:59. I'm like, man, they're gonna go over. They're gonna go over, and all Shane does is he walks out and says that AJ is not having a poem for WrestleMania. Well, he does now. And they cut right there. As soon as he says the word now, cuts.
That's it.
It's like a WCW ending, man. I'm like, wow. They really cut that close. And it has to do with the network thing. I get it. It just, they're so rushed. Like I said in the beginning of the review, it was so rushed.
And they had the backstage thing with Bryan.
Crisis, the Hype Bros as well. We missed that tag team, but because Zack Ryder's injured.
Yeah, great. But no, they had the backstage thing where Styles was walking out and Bryan comes out. Bryan.
So what happens to Styles now? He's fired.
Well, how
does he get back into the world title picture?
Said, what are you gonna
do on the Raw?
Bryan said, "What are you gonna do? Fire?" Or Styles said, "What are you gonna do? Fire me?" And Bryan said, "You damn right, I'm not get the hell out."
So I think we're gonna get more clarification next week.
Does he actually get fired?
Shane reinstates him and says, "Yeah, I want to have his match with him, so he's gotta get reinstated." Or maybe they prolonged it. Styles like, "No, I don't want to re-sign with your brand."
We had two people get fired this week, but not really get fired. Foley and Styles.
Yeah.
Both didn't actually get fired, but they technically got fired.
I don't understand. Whatever. Couple things I want to mention about SmackDown this week. You guys obviously saw it. Ronaldo wasn't there. And it was due to him missing SmackDown due to weather. And
apparently
there was mixed reviews on this.
Mixed things about he had an appearance for something else.
And saying that people are saying, oh, well, if he knew about the storm days before, he should have made plans to get himself there. And it was unprofessional and... I don't know. I don't know how I feel about the whole situation. Because I don't know Ronaldo's life. I'm not like the fly in the wall. I don't know what's going on. But I'm not putting my opinion out there because I don't know. I'm just saying that I saw a lot of mixed reviews around this, but it did suck without Ronaldo there.
Okay? I can't handle Tom Phillips as the lead commentator on SmackDown.
No, he's not lead commentator material. As much as people want to say he has got potential, he's not.
He's nowhere near what Ronaldo is.
He's a backstage guy. Tom Phillips.
Ronaldo brings so much to the show. Yeah. I felt like the commentators gave us nothing tonight.
Yeah.
With JBL and Tom.
They only had two. Because Otunga was off filming stuff. You know, keep filming stuff with Otunga. We don't need you back.
I didn't even remember him. Yeah. That's how much I missed him.
One thing some people are pointing out that I've pointed out in the past and I haven't really brought up on the show is the talking smack how Bryan and Renee Young should stick to just Raw talk and Daniel Bryan should get a new host on Talking Smack because the chemistry, people said, between Daniel Bryan and Renee Young just doesn't feel right. And they're saying that this week's Talking Smack was probably the shittiest one that they've ever done. I kind of agree with that. I don't get the good vibe from her. She can stick on Raw. It just doesn't make sense for her to be on SmackDown, to be on Talking Smack.
I didn't watch it this week.
I thought of a good replacement for Renee Young, that Rosenberg guy. I think him and Bryan could have a really good thing going there for Talking Smack. Rosemary likes to lay it out on the line. So is Daniel Bryan.
But he does.
That's what the point of Talking Smack is. They go overboard. They break the fourth wall.
He's on the Yes Network, though.
Yeah.
On the Michael Kay show.
That's just, you know, an opinion.
Maybe our girl Charlie Caruso.
Charlie Caruso.
Inter-tour championship.
Other than that was SmackDown. And I'm going to give it this week a 5. I'm just going to get half a rating because it was only half a good show. Some wrestling, more promos, half a good show, 5 out of 10. So it barely won again. Like I said, it barely won for me this week.
I'm going to say it wins by the skin of its Kevin Dunn front teeth.
Bugs Bunny back there.
4.5 out of 10.
What's up, Raw?
4.5 out of 10, and Raw gets a 4. I forgot to mention Jericho putting this backstage guy on the list.
Oh, yeah.
That he called Tom Phillips, but it wasn't actually Tom Phillips. I forget his name. If you know his name, I really don't care what his name is, but whatever. And he said, I know who Tom Phillips is. That guy followed me around all summer long. You know what happens when you don't say they think that I know your name? You know what happens? And then he clicks the pen.
Yeah.
You just made the list.
Speaking of, you bought one of those.
I did at WWE Buffalo.
The live event last week.
Speaking of WWE Buffalo, holy shit. What an event. Actually, the event sucked until the main event.
Yeah.
But the main event was awesome. It was a 6-man tag with Balor.
The main event was you buying the list of Jericho.
Yeah. I went to buy that during the Big Show Lesnar squash match. The match literally lasted 1 F5, but Paul Heyman cut a 5-minute promo before the match.
Yeah. Greg says he should be the new host of Talking Smack. Yeah, Greg, get in there, man.
Or maybe he means Jericho.
No, he says, what about Glorious Greg as the new host of Talking
Smack? I don't know. You're going to have to fight real Michael Chow for that, you know?
Twitter beef.
And if anybody saw, I did the live Periscope, whatever, of Balor's entrance, and it got like 8,000 views on it.
People love it because people were asking for it on Twitter. People were like, someone better Periscope his return. You got a lot of views for that.
That was crazy. I didn't even know about that.
So I wish we had a lot of views for our videos, what you're saying. Anyways, let's move on to the next segment of the show, and that is the list of 10.
10.
You know what? You know what happens? You know what's going to happen? You just made the list.
That's right. Welcome to the list of 10, the part of the show where me and Cobra Cappy each have 5 moments from the week and we give it a rating of 10 or a list rating. So this is a great part of the show. I love that theme. I just love that theme song, man. So great. So guys, we each have 5 moments. We give it a 10 rating or we give it a, you know, you just made the list moment. So we'll start off as always with Cobra Cappy.
Might as well start off with the list. Big Show versus Titus O'Neil in a pointless fucking squash match 3 weeks away from WrestleMania. Why was this on my television? Why is this on anything? What do I care about this for? Why is it there? Is Big Show going to face Shaq or is he not going to face Shaq?
We don't even know. There's no clear cut.
And if he's
answer.
Not, we got Titus catering O'Neil back here. Probably didn't give Big Show his meat backstage.
That's probably why that didn't match. Why wasn't there a Facebook Live video for this?
I don't know. I don't care about this match. This match sucked. And for that,
you know what? You just made the list.
Why was it on TV?
Oh man,
you're lucky you didn't have to sit through this.
Yeah. Interesting. Not really. My first moment of the week. It's a list moment.
Of course it and is.
Coincidentally, it has something to do with Big Show. Big Show injuring Rusev. Great. So a part timer hurts a full timer. Vince is the most blamed for this, okay? And his ongoing love for part-timers, man, I blame him. Rusev is going to miss WrestleMania this year. But is it a huge loss? What's he going to do? What was he supposed
to do?
It's not
like he's being built up like he was a couple years ago.
What's going to happen now to Lana and Hard Buddy Mahal? I'm concerned.
Well, Hard Buddy Mahal is on his own.
I'm very concerned for both of them right now. But apparently Lana is going to go do some NXT stuff and some in-ring stuff. So good for
handsome
her.
Rusev.
Other than that, Big Show for you retiring Rusev.
You know what? You just made the list.
Yes, you make the list.
Did he retire him for good or just injure him?
I don't know. We'll find out.
Big Show really wants this match with Shaq, and apparently Shaq doesn't want it.
Yeah. Greg, if you can, I know you're listening right now. Greg, let me know. I've put the sound clips into a different part of the app here. Tell me if you can hear it. Let me know right now in the chat. Can you hear those sound effects, the list and the list sounds? Let me know. And while he lets me know, I'm going to get Corporate Cappy to list his next moment.
So my first 10 moment goes to AJ and Shane backstage segments this week. I thought they were great. I mean, as much as the match, you might not like the match, I thought they intensified the feud with, I mean, obviously Styles throwing Shane through the friggin' car window. I thought that was awesome. And then Shane looking all bloodied and coming out. I know it ended SmackDown kind of shitty, but they had AJ getting fired by Daniel, and I thought it was really well done. And for that, the feud backstage gets a
10. Okay. And then Greg can hear him, so we're good. Yeah, I agree. Okay, I like the feud. I like the build-up. I don't like the match. Plain and simple. My next moment is a 10 moment. Interesting, right? I'm starting off early with a 10. Is this for real? And as the inclusion of the tag teams on SmackDown this week, they're finally out of the dark match cave. American Alpha faced Usos in the main event of SmackDown. Well, really, it was really less than spectacular because we got
Shane
overshadowing
it. Could
have
been way better for a main event.
Yeah. It looks like that's probably going to be the match at Mania with this lack of build-up. Other than that, I'm happy them finally getting some TV time. And for that, the tag teams on SmackDown get a perfect
10. Yes. You sure about all the tag teams or just American Alpha?
Whatever. We got some sort of tag team. Anything. Usually we don't get anything.
My next 10 moment goes to Austin Aries' in-ring debut and at 205 Live becoming the number one contender for the Cruiserweight title, like we said earlier in the show. He's going to do great things and be looks like he's going to be a face, I guess, but he's going to be like that douchey,
cocky face. Kind of like Roman Reigns tries to do, but people just don't like it.
Like a Dean Ambrose type where he's kind of a heel, but he's really a face. Yeah. But I really like Austin Aries, obviously. His work in NXT was great, and I think he's getting really over for the work that he's done on commentary, and it's only going to go over to his in-ring debut and his run. So hopefully he'll win the Cruiserweight title at WrestleMania, and for that, Austin Aries this week gets a
10. Yes. 100%.
For the greatest man that ever lived.
Yeah. My next moment is a list moment, and WWE most likely going through with Shane versus Styles, the match. Great build up. Dream match alert. Hello? Ding, 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 ding. No, it's not. So bad, man. There's so many other things they could have done with this. They could have the good feud, but the match could be so much better. Like Nakamura, Kurt Angle, to name a few, man. I'll back the feud up. I don't like the match. This is going to be bad, people. Mark my words. Styles will carry that entire match. And just for that, for them making that match at WrestleMania.
You know what? You just made the list.
Yeah. Just in my opinion. Just my straight opinion. We're all tied into our opinions. Mason Dunbar says Aries is awesome. Yes, he is freaking awesome.
My last list moment of the week goes to not Roman Reigns.
So
Roman Reigns, you have been exempt from this week's list.
You get a pass.
Yeah.
Surprisingly.
Your streak is over for now. I'm sure you'll make it back next week. But I had to talk about the New Day talk show. Why do they have their own backstage talk show now on Raw? New Day is absolutely cringe. I saw them at WWE Buffalo. They came out with their stupid ice cream cart, and they had the blow up Bootios box. Every time New Day comes on TV, I can't. Like, I used to love these guys, but I want to throw up my Bootios box. That's how bad it's getting.
Oh God, that's bad. No, we worked hard for that. You can't do that.
But the New Day talk show, really?
Yeah, I know.
Why is this needed? Why is this
even
a thing?
They need something for WrestleMania to do.
So, for the host of WrestleMania and the New Day talk show...
You know what? You just made the list!
The longest reigning tag team champions, and then they don't even go for their titles back.
Yeah. Greg says, Glorious Greg versus Michael Chow for 2017 Twitter Fan of the Year. Could that be Match of the Year? Hashtag, what do you think, man? We'll see. It's still like what, 6 months? Or, well,
six.
8 months? Eight?
More than that.
Eight, 9 months? Yep. Long way to go, Greg. Long way to go. My next moment is a 10 moment. And it's Carmella actually not being completely useless this week. Although she was followed by that thing. That cringe thing, cringe
word. Turtle without a shell, as JBL says.
Carmella looked very strong this week, super kicking both Becky and Natty. Laying them out, and definitely people that are going to be in the championship match at WrestleMania. Hopefully this continues the next couple weeks and we actually get some more decent showings by Carmella. Definitely worth it and definitely needed if you're going to be in this championship match. And hopefully we get just a round of people looking strong, not just one. I mean, in a way, it should be just one. It should be Alexa Bliss, but it looks like they're going a different route. But for Carmella looking strong this week, it gets a perfect
10.
I mean, she looks like a perfect 10 every week, too, but we won't get into that. Mm. My last 10 moment this week goes to your boy, Kevin Owens.
I
thought his promo was good, and the beatdown on Jericho and Zayn by Owens and Joe was good. And I like that they're bringing back the old KO that we know and love from NXT.
The one where he was Universal Champion and he was just completely useless with the belt.
I really think that they're finally going back to the old Kevin Owens, the brutal, don't give a fuck about anybody Kevin Owens.
Yeah.
The bruiser, the great heel that he used to be before he...
With the bruiserweight, potentially.
Yeah, well, I didn't say that. But no, I like this the Kevin Owens that they're showing now. It's too bad that they waited until after he lost the title to bring this back.
Yeah.
But for that, Kevin Owens gets a...
10.
Yeah. I agree. My last moment is a 10 moment. So it's not a list. I got a lot of 10s this week.
Wow.
That goes to the Wyatt promo. Unreal production of this promo, man. Just... Great build-up, great feud for Mania. It has WrestleMania. It's almost the only feud right now that's worthy of WrestleMania, in a way. So intense, Bray basically being the new face of Fear. He's basically established himself these last couple of weeks. Thank God Bray is getting the time, man. What he's done or where he's come from and the amount of time he's put into the WWE without saying a word, man, it just is well-deserved. I hope they have a really good match. I hope that actually steals the show, man. I'm really looking forward to it. And for that... Bray Wyatt and the promo and this whole feud gets a perfect
10.
Yeah. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
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 No more Husky Harris.
So that is it for the list of 10, guys. Those are our moments for the week. And into that last part of the show, WWE headlines. Hit that headline music. That That's right. Welcome to WWE Headlines, a part of the show where we talk about any important news, any trending news in the WWE. Before we get into that, Mason Dunbar says, I predict Asuka will be a surprise entrant in the SmackDown Open Invitation. Interesting.
Well, let's see.
I think Asuka will be somewhere at WrestleMania or the night after.
Well, she has been touring on the SmackDown house shows, but... Yeah.
Interesting. So we get into the news, guys. Some couple headlines for you here. Kurt Angle, it was announced today, his inductee,
or his inductor,
is chosen.
And you can't see him.
And you can't see him because it's John Cena.
Is he gonna? Is no one gonna be up at the stage?
Yeah. I think Cena's up there. Where is he, man? This next part's coming from Dirty.com. Cena was a long way from becoming a 16-time world champion in June 27, 2002, when he accepted the Olympic gold medalist's open challenge, believing he had the ruthless aggression to defeat Angle before striking him. Though he did not earn the victory, Cena established himself as a force to be reckoned with in the WWE. Angle and Cena would remain rivals throughout the later rise of the without his later rise to superstardom, even battling over the WWE Championship in 2005. Now Cena will present Angle to the WWE Universe for the first time in more than a decade as an official WWE Hall of Famer.
I know you didn't originally like this, but like I was telling you, he did have his first match with Kurt Angle, and he did have good feuds.
Yeah. I think could have been Stone Cold, though. Well, kind of feel like Stone Cold maybe should have been more deserving than John Cena, but...
Kurt Angle's best feud of all time was with Stone Cold and the whole Attitude Era thing with the WWF title. Yeah. I would have liked to see Stone Cold do it as well, but I'm not... I don't hate John Cena doing it.
We know how good he is with speeches, so you know his speech is going to be very, very well-fitting and very professional, so that's probably one of the reasons why they chose John Cena.
What happens if Angle becomes a GM of SmackDown, then Cena's going to have to kiss
his ass?
They're
going to bring that up, man. I think it's a smart idea. Maybe they're planting seeds with this. Who knows? But it'll be interesting. We'll see what happens. Next bit of news, some Shinsuke Nakamura news, and this is creating a lot of Twitter chatter just because of this. NXT recently advertised an upcoming UK tour, and they have a poster of it. It's featuring superstars such as Ty Dillinger, Eric Young, Bobby Roode, Cassius Ohno, Nikki Cross, and others. One notable name that's off the poster is Shinsuke Nakamura, which is further leads to speculation that Nakamura is going to be called up sometime soon or leading up to that June UK upcoming tour. So,
I thought they said that he wasn't ready yet because he can't speak English and cut promos.
Yeah. But now he's off the poster, man. This poster is advertising is returned to the UK, and Nakamura is nowhere on the poster.
So I guess that means Bobby Roode's retaining.
And he's staying. Looks like maybe they all of a sudden just they're like, oh, maybe we'll go with Bobby Roode for the rest of the year. Maybe Nakamura's ready to go. Maybe Vince wants Nakamura on Raw. I hope he goes to SmackDown. I really hope he does. So we'll see what happens with Nakamura.
I feel like they wouldn't use him properly on Raw. At all.
And speaking of, we got a TakeOver Orlando update here. So with this past week's NXT, Shinsuke Nakamura will face Bobby Roode for the NXT Championship at TakeOver Orlando. The tag team title match is set in place. It'll be a triple threat tag team match. So it'll be Authors of Pain versus DIY versus Revival. I think that's going to be a freaking insane match. I cannot wait for that tag team title match.
Yeah, they had. I watched NXT last night. They had that opening set. Authors of Pain beat up on some... I forget what they're called, the Ely brothers or something. Yeah. I don't even know who those guys are.
Tag team coming
so
in.
They squashed them, and then DIY came out, and then the Revival came out, and then my boy Regal came out and announced that it's going to be a triple threat elimination match.
Ooh.
So it's going to be elimination
style.
That's
going to be sick. Greg says, yes, my father will keep his title. Glorious, Greg.
Do you have the documents for that? Yeah. Is he actually your dad?
Yeah, we need to see proper documentation, Greg. Please.
You born
that.
In Toronto?
Yeah. Yeah, if you're born in Toronto, what street were you born at? Yeah, don't you dare Google and pick a random street. Anyways, those two tag team matches, or those two title matches, join the already Ember Moon and Asuka NXT Women's title match. That's going to be sick. The two undefeated women,
event.
Man.
It's going to be a really good event.
That's going to like beat half of WrestleMania's card, you know, if not three quarters of it. So, we'll have a lot to talk about that on the Lowdown in Orlando. Next bit of news, guys. Backstage news on the two moves Vince McMahon wants to do at this year's WWE draft. So, the WWE landscape dramatically changed last July following a 2016 draft. Raw Commissioner Stephanie McMahon and Raw General Manager Mick Foley, Commissioners Shane McMahon and SmackDown Live General Manager Daniel Bryan picked superstars to come to their respective brands. WWE plans to hold another draft sometime this year. However, it won't be full-fledged draft like last year, but rather a series of trades to freshen up the WWE landscape. WWE plans on having Raw and SmackDown Live authority figures pick superstars from the opposite brand as well as NXT. Champions will not be eligible for the draft. Raw and SmackDown Live can protect, quote-unquote protect, certain superstars.
Why don't they just call... Sorry. Why don't they just call it WWE Trade Center?
Yeah. While there hasn't been much discussion internally about which superstars will switch brands, AJ Styles to Raw and The New Day to SmackDown are the two moves Vince has brought up multiple occasions during creative meetings. SmackDown gets The New Day? What?
I guess it would spice up the tag team division again.
Yeah.
But they need another... You can't just replace AJ Styles
with
New Day.
That's so out of left field. That must be just like two main ones. He probably has brains going to Raw or SmackDown. But like his main concern is for New Day. He probably hates New Day so much he just wants to move him to SmackDown. I don't know.
That's probably why they're the hosts and they're not on the actual card.
Yeah, we'll see. Next bit of news is Seth Rollins news. And that has to do with this week on Raw. According to the Pro Wrestling Sheet, Rollins' status for WrestleMania 33 is actually still up in the air. Although he was cleared by doctors this week, but he had restrictions. Meaning they cleared him for some in-ring activities, but not an actual match. This is why he was able to mix it up in the ring with Triple H. That said, many people in WWE management feel that management is rushing Rollins back in. And it's not good for his long-term health, and that he should be taking more months to focus on his rehab since the risk of getting injured again is currently very high.
I mean, with his injury history...
I agree with the people backstage, man. Do not rush Rollins, man. He's your top, one of the top guys. Take it easy, okay? Everyone freaking relax.
And if he gets another major injury, he could be done.
Yeah. Some more things about the draft. Although AJ Styles has been moved to the alumni section, WWE.com.
Wow, they really went dramatic with that.
And fired from SmackDown. The match is not officially announced, but Styles is still set to face Shane McMahon at WrestleMania 33. Great. And it's likely that Styles will get hired, quote-unquote, by the Raw brand following the WrestleMania match.
But then if he gets hired by Raw and they bring over Nakamura, that's like way too much for Raw.
You're going to have to put Nakamura on SmackDown if Styles goes to Raw.
You're going to have way too many guys.
Yeah. Or maybe Zayn goes along to SmackDown. This draft trade, whatever that's going to be called, is going to be very, very interesting. So, and I like it. Okay, last bit of news. And I filled Corporate Cappy on this before the show. And it has to do with Casey Salas' question earlier in the show. I can't believe when I read this today, I almost threw up. I almost puked. The Wrestling Observer newsletter is reporting that WWE officials already have a match planned for next year's WrestleMania. You already have something planned for the main event next year's WrestleMania? Already? Seriously? You don't know what's going to happen in like a year from now. Anyways.
What if someone fails a drug test?
Oh my god. The rumored main event match for the Universal Championship is Brock Lesnar versus Roman Reigns. Are you fucking kidding me?
Wow.
Are you kidding me?
So they expect Reigns to turn heel and then back face by the end
Why
of next
Why is Lesnar... I'm getting mad at this. So they note that this does not mean WWE's plans for next year include Roman beating Undertaker at this year or Brock holding the title for a full year. According to reports, the goal is very likely much that Reigns is the next John Cena of the company. How? You're going to career suicide his ass at this year's WrestleMania. He's going to be just as bad at next year's WrestleMania. Doesn't make sense. I don't agree with this. I hope something changes. I hope someone, you know, fails a drug policy. We don't have to have this match. But I just love how they're already thinking of the main event next year and they don't even know what's going to happen. And of course, take this with a grain of salt, ladies and gentlemen. But if that's the case...
With those two guys?
I don't... God.
They already had it last 2 years ago when Rollins won, cashed in the middle of the match.
Yep.
Why do we need to see this again?
I hope it's just someone misreading.
Someone trolling hardcore. Because if it's those two guys...
I'm not even going to go to next year's WrestleMania.
I'll leave. We'll leave at the main event.
We'll start. Anyways, this is the last bit of news. Yeah, nothing else.
You end them on that? Come on, we need to end them on something nice.
Okay, nice. Tune into the Lowdown in Orlando. There's something nice, guys. Again, Lowdown in Orlando, Saturday, April 1st, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. All day podcast. We're going to take Skype calls. I got some contests lined up for that, so stay tuned for that and some more information throughout the next couple of weeks leading up to that show. So there you go. There's the high note for you. How about that?
Good.
How about that? And you like? Do you like it?
I liked it.
Other than that, guys, that is going to wrap it up for this week's Lowdown Show. Week number 49 of the Lowdown Show Brand Awards on the Holds Barred Wrestling Podcast. We are a Canadian-based WWE podcast that reviews and discusses Monday Night Raw and Tuesday Night SmackDown from the past week. Also, during the show, we have our segment called The List of 10. And there will be headlines where we talk about any important news related to the WWE. Remember, every week the Lowdown Show is broadcasted live right here on Spreaker, available at Spreaker.com/NHBWP or on the Spreaker app, available for all Apple and Android devices. After we're done recording, this podcast will be posted in full on Spreaker itself, our YouTube channel, YouTube.com/NHBWP, and it'll also be available on iTunes by searching the Lowdown Show Brand Wars. You can follow the podcast on Twitter, join the conversation, and have your thoughts and questions read right here on the podcast by tweeting and following us at NoHoldsBarredWP. I am your host, the self-proclaimed greatest host, Kyle Masters. And I, every week, continue to be joined by my co-host, the blissful boss, Mr. Corporate himself, Corporate Cappy.
WWE Shop, don't bliss me off. I got an order on the way.
And as always, we're here reminding you to keep it on the lowdown.
You're looking at the real deal now. Woo! Gonna kick your sorry ass out on the street. Is that what you want?